Hello, fellow hoopheads and bracketeers. I'm Mike DeCourcy, college basketball writer at Sporting News since 1995. I've covered every Final Four since, and guess what? We're actually going to have a Final Four this year after an empty 2020. Isn't it nice to have a bracket to hold in our hands again and to try to make the picks? And I will show you what picks I've made over the course of the next few minutes. So let's start our picks in the West region. Why in the West? Because that's where the number one overall team, Gonzaga, happens to reside for this NCAA tournament. Now, of course, the West is in Indianapolis, just like every other region. The entire tournament will be played in the state of Indiana with some games in Bloomington and West Lafayette, but the vast majority in the city of Indianapolis. And Gonzaga starts out with a game between Norfolk State or Appalachian State. That game will be played in the first four, the App State-Norfolk State game. I suspect App State will advance, although it's very difficult to judge games that are played, especially in a year when there was so little intersection between them, between different conferences and different levels of opponents. I think App State is in a stronger conference, and we'll see how that goes. But Norfolk State has played very well of late. Wouldn't surprise me to see them advance, but would shock me beyond belief if either of them were able to beat Gonzaga. I think the Zags will be in the second round. Oklahoma and Missouri, really difficult game to call because neither team has been able to muster great consistency. But Missouri is the more perplexing team of the two. So I advanced Oklahoma to play in that game. Creighton left a very bad taste with their performance against Georgetown in the Big East Championship game. A title at stake, and you go out and you get run off the floor by a team that entered the game with a 500 record. Not good. But I still think their players are too good to likely lose to UC Santa Barbara. Virginia and Ohio, if you want to pick the upset of the tournament, you can pick Ohio to beat Virginia. Ohio has a really strong roster. They went into Illinois very early in the non-conference season and came to the final possession against the Fighting Illini before losing. So that would be an upset you could pick. I'm not picking it. Virginia is a little too consistent for me. We have seen them lose early in tournaments before. You may know about that. But if there's a team from the double digits that can make a run to the Sweet 16, Ohio's your team. I just don't feel comfortable putting it on my bracket. Southern California against the winner between Wichita and Drake. I selected Drake. I'm bothered by Drake's circumstance with their great guard Roman Penn being likely unavailable for that game. But I still think they're a better basketball team than Wichita, which played exceedingly poorly in their conference tournament at a time when they could not feel safe about getting in. Still went out and nearly lost to South Florida, not a good South Florida team. Nearly lost to did lose to Cincinnati and went home, but still got into the tournament in one of the last spots. From there, you go to Kansas versus Eastern Washington. There's very good strength on the 14 seed line in this event, but I think that's a bit of a reach for them to take out Kansas, even a compromised Kansas team. If they're short one or more players, we have seen it reported that Jalen Wilson, their terrific freshman forward, may not be available. We've seen it reported that David McCormack, their center, will be late to Indianapolis because of protocols. But I still think that I expect McCormack to play from what I've been able to gather. And either way, I still expect them to go through. VCU against Oregon. I think Oregon is a really solid basketball team with a great player in Chris Duarte, won the Pac-10 championship. I have them moving forward against VCU. Iowa versus Grand Canyon, move the Hawkeyes along. They're going to play in this deal for a while, I believe. Second round, Gonzaga against Oklahoma, still favoring the Zags, no question. Creighton against Virginia. I think the defense does it for the Cavaliers. Kansas against Southern Cal, really difficult game to follow, and this is where the availability of Kansas's best players is essential. If they are a compromised team at that stage of the tournament, Southern Cal will manage to pull it off. Evan Mobley, one of the great talents in this tournament, I think they'll have trouble defending him, even if David McCormack is available. But if he or someone else were not, I could see the Trojans move through. I did pick Kansas because I picked thinking they would be full strength. We'll see how that goes. Iowa over Oregon. Tough call because of having Dane Altman on the other bench and Chris Duarte. That one's going to be tough, but I have Iowa moving forward. Gonzaga versus Virginia. This game has already happened once, and Gonzaga won by 25. I don't think it'll be that easy this time, but I do think that the Zags move on. Kansas versus Iowa, even at full strength, Kansas is not consistent enough, doesn't defend well enough to take down Iowa. So regional final, Iowa versus Gonzaga, the Zags moving on. I used to say the Zags would move on to Indianapolis or they would move on to San Antonio. Can't say that now. They're already in Indianapolis. So you have to say they're just moving on to the Final Four. You can't even say they're moving on to Lucas Oil Stadium because they're playing the Elite Eight in Lucas Oil Stadium. So they're moving on to the Final Four. That's what I say. And we'll move on to the next region. From there, we move to the region opposite the West. And that would be the East region, which is where Michigan is the number one seed. And they will play in the first round against the 16 seed winner between Mount St. Mary's and Texas Southern. Texas Southern did a great job at the end of the season under Johnny Jones, and Mount St. Mary's won a very difficult tournament in the Northeast Conference. But I have Mount St. Mary's going in to play Michigan and then losing after one game. Obviously, 1 versus 16 has only happened once that the 16 seed has won, and this will not make it twice. From there, LSU against St. Bonaventure, one of the really fascinating games on the bracket. LSU, among the most dynamic offensive teams in this tournament. There are very few teams. And I'm talking about, you have to go to the very top, to teams like Gonzaga and Illinois, to find one with three offensive players as dynamic as Trenton Watford, Cameron Thomas, and Javonte Smart. And they play just terrifically dynamic as an offensive unit. They do not play with the same energy and enthusiasm as a defensive unit. They are not very effective, only 125th in the country in defensive efficiency. And maybe that gets them beat. I think as great as St. Bonaventure is defensively, I think that firepower is just too much and that LSU moves on and becomes a danger to Michigan. Colorado versus Georgetown. This is one where I went with the 12-5 upset. Georgetown, the team that won the Big East tournament with 4 wins in 4 days, and only then did they squeeze over the 500 mark, playing against a Colorado team that had a chance to win a Pac-12 championship against Oregon State and just did not come out with the kind of inspiration I expected. I did not like what I saw in that game from Colorado. They looked somewhat inert, and as a result, I have Georgetown pulling the upset here. Then you move to the Florida State game versus UNC Greensboro. Greensboro had a great year in the Southern Conference. Wes Miller doing a great job. Florida State, little disappointing down the stretch, had chances to win 2 championships in the last 8 days of the season. Regular season at Notre Dame, finale, they win, they're the champs, didn't bring it. ACC tournament, championship game, Georgia Tech, they gave the ball away 25 times. So made me a little bit less enthusiastic about Florida State. But still, I believe that they're capable of beating Greensboro. Michigan State, UCLA in the 11 seed game. I don't know exactly what you're going to get from Michigan State, but I do wonder whether UCLA, with all the injuries that they've had, with the loss of their backup big guy, I just think that that being the case, there's just not enough firepower left there. Did a great job to get into the tournament under those circumstances. Michigan State should send them home, should. If they don't, it'll be another disappointment in a season that's been filled with a lot for the Spartans, but I think they'll win that game and then play BYU. And I think if they're able to beat UCLA, I think that the Spartans can get it together enough to beat BYU as well. Texas versus Abilene Christian. Mentioned before, the 14 seeds in this tournament are really good. They did not have a lot of upsets in conference tournaments at that level. Abilene Christian has had a great year, but Texas has so much size and such depth and those big guards. I just don't think that's the type of team that a mid-major opponent is going to do well against. UConn versus Maryland, tough game to call, very difficult. I could see this going either way. But I think Sanogo, their big guy, starting to give a little definition to the offense. James Bouknight's had a string of games that maybe not quite at his level. I think James comes back and has a better game here, and I think UConn moves on. And then Alabama against Iona. How do you think Nate Oates felt when he saw that he would be having to coach against Rick Pitino in a 15-2 game? I mean, Rick Pitino in the Final Four, you can live with that. But in a first-round game against a 15 seed, not something you've seen every day. I'm not sure we've seen that in a long time. So I'm sure that Nate Oates was not thrilled. And the Crimson Tide are going to have to deal with a well-coached team. But I do think the Tide move on. Michigan versus LSU, you could see the upset there. I picked Michigan because I'm afraid to get it wrong and lose a number one seed that's capable of winning it all. So I did pick them, but that's a game that if you want to see an 8-9 advance, it's that one or Carolina beating Baylor. Those are the only two that I see happening. Georgetown, Florida State. Florida State moves on. Georgetown, I don't think they have two wins in them in this event. One, maybe two. That's a lot. Florida State moves on. Michigan State against Texas. Longhorns, really tough team. I say they move forward. UConn, Alabama. Alabama, again, great defensive team, really consistent. The offensive end is still a work in progress, but when they make shots, they're devastating. Then in the Sweet 16, Michigan over Florida State. A tough game, but I think that the Wolverines will take the ball away just often enough to fuel their offense. Texas against Alabama. I have said this on several occasions. The toughest game to call of games that have yet to be established in this tournament. Teams have to win to get to establish that game as being something we'll see. If that game happens, Texas versus Alabama, toughest game to call. I went with Alabama for the reason that Javon Quinterly is becoming so consistent as a point guard. I see him taking the Longhorns down with his ability. Alabama against Michigan in the regional final. I think that Michigan, without Isaiah Livers, without their star forward Isaiah Livers, can win three games in this tournament. But four, five, or six, that's a lot. Michigan versus Alabama, I have the Crimson Tide moving on to the Final Four, where they would play the Zags in a chance to take down the unbeaten season. Going to move on to the South region, which is the most difficult of all the regions to call. You will see more different winners out of this one, the South, than any of the other three. Maybe more different winners than the other three combined in your various bracket pools. I have Baylor easily moving past Hartford. North Carolina versus Wisconsin, tough call. The Badgers are supposed to be better with seniors. That's the modern day ethic in college basketball. But as juniors, this group won the Big Ten regular season championship. As seniors, they went 10-10 in the league. So seniors, maybe not always as much help as people think. Carolina's hoping that because they are a very young team that is on its way to being an outstanding team in 2021-22. I think an experience of winning a NCAA tournament game here would be great for them in moving into next season. I do think they get the win over Wisconsin. Villanova against Winthrop is a game that a lot of people are picking the upset, and I understand why, but I also think they're kind of guessing. Winthrop's a terrific team, but they also have not played a lot of high major competition this year. We don't really know how they'll react to that. And that's not a criticism. I mean, Winthrop and everybody else in the country, you got on the floor against who you could get on the floor against. And for Winthrop, it was mostly Big South Conference teams. And the reason we know that Winthrop is really good is because they dominated those teams. You don't dominate in college basketball without being exception in any league. And that translates to playing other levels of teams effectively. But it's a lot to ask for them to go out and play their first high major game and be successful. And so I suspect that we'll see Villanova move along. Purdue, North Texas, not a hard call for me. Boilermakers advance. Texas Tech versus Utah State, really difficult call. One of the more difficult in the first round. Similar teams, similar weaknesses. The thing that Utah State has over Texas Tech is size. Nemus Keita, tremendous big guy. Texas Tech doesn't have that, so could be an upset for the Aggies. But Texas Tech has been in so many battles, and I think they've, it's not like the first time they face a good big guy. Texas has a bunch of them. So I think they'll be able to hold up and move along. But wouldn't surprise me to see Texas Tech in the Elite Eight or lose in the first round as a result of that matchup. Arkansas Colgate going to be a fun game, but more fun for the Razorbacks. They advance. Florida Virginia Tech, don't really know what to expect from Virginia Tech. They had such a long pause entering the ACC tournament and then didn't stick around very long in that tournament to get their game conditioning back, so to speak. Difficult then to ask them to go out and beat a solid Florida team. Not impossible, but I have the Gators. And Ohio State against Oral Roberts. Oral Roberts is a fun team. Max Abmas, leading scorer in the country. You're going to want to watch him when you get the chance, but you better get to it quickly because I think they're only going to be around for one round. Baylor, Carolina in the second round. Baylor, superior, all-around team. Carolina bother Baylor a little bit with their big guys, but not enough to take down the Bears. Villanova against Purdue. The Boilermakers will be advancing because this is where being a diminished team starts to bother the Wildcats when they play a team with as much depth and variety of ways in which they can beat you as the Boilers do. Texas Tech against Arkansas. I do think that Arkansas becomes entrapped in a game that's more to Texas Tech's liking. And Texas Tech advances to the Sweet 16. Ohio State against Florida, great matchup for the Buckeyes. They move on to the Sweet 16 as well. There, Purdue versus Baylor. Now, I think a lot of people will tell you that Baylor, since the COVID pause that they had nearly 3 weeks, is not the same defensive team as they were prior. I will tell you that they were already starting to decline. Based on the numbers say that they were starting to decline before that. Maybe they've lost their edge a little bit. Now, maybe they just were playing too many Big 12 teams that knew how to go against Baylor and knew what the weaknesses were. And maybe there was a little bit for the Bears of let's just get to the NCAA tournament in their approach. Hard to say, but we can say that Purdue is set up well to beat them. A variety, as I said, of big guys that they can use. A lot of fouls available to them. I think Travion Williams will be hard for Baylor to defend when they take out Travion and put in Zach Edey. There's nobody on Baylor that's equipped to defend Edey. They'll push him, and maybe they can move him out, but maybe they'll also be called for fouls. I have Purdue moving on into the Elite Eight with a rare 4-1 upset pick. Ohio State beats Texas Tech to play a Purdue team that they have faced on several occasions, including as recently as a week ago in the Big Ten tournament. In that game, Ohio State got a huge lead. Purdue made an amazing comeback to close and tie the game and push it into overtime. Buckeyes recovered, were able to get to the Big Ten championship game by winning that game. But I still think that Purdue, with what they have and with another chance to take down the Buckeyes, I think this one is the one that gets them back to the Final Four for the first time since 1980. They did not make it under Gene Cady. They had one free throw to make against Virginia in 2019, the last time we had a tournament. Did not make that free throw, and as a result, got tied at the buzzer and lost in overtime. This time, I think they make it home, and that will be a very happy occasion for the very many Boilers fans who populate the state of Indiana and the Indianapolis area. Final region. The Midwest region where Illinois is the number one seed and I suspect will make it all the way to the Final Four, but let's see how they get there. Certainly by starting it off with a win over Drexel. Loyola, Georgia Tech, 8-9 games, always tough to call. Loyola, a much more consistent basketball team though. There are a lot of people complaining about the fact that they were put into an 8-9 game. I think Georgia Tech in some ways was punished for winning the ACC tournament. If they had lost in the final against Florida State, they probably would have gotten a 10 seed. It might have meant them playing a little deeper into this event, but better for them to hang the ACC tournament banner because I don't think they're a Final Four level team anyway. That ACC tournament's going to mean something. Making the Sweet 16 or the second round maybe doesn't mean quite as much. So Loyola moves along to play Illinois. In the Tennessee versus Oregon State game, Oregon State did a nice run in order to get to the Pac-12 championship, but Tennessee, even though they are wildly inconsistent on offense, I think their defense carries the day in this one. Oklahoma State against Liberty. Liberty, again, a fine 13 seed, terrific season, but Oklahoma State has Cade Cunningham, and I think that's a difference in almost every game that they'll play in this event. San Diego State against Syracuse, fascinating game. Syracuse has come into this tournament on so many occasions with teams that didn't have overwhelming regular seasons and beat teams that did have overwhelming regular seasons. And San Diego State, which has lost only four times all year and won the Mountain West regular season and tournament championship, had an overwhelming season. And now they have to go against the Syracuse zone. The Syracuse zone in 2018, they play against Michigan State, a terrific Michigan State team that had future pros, high first round picks, Miles Bridges and Jaren Jackson, and couldn't go anywhere against the Syracuse zone and lost in the second round as a three seed. You go back before that to 2013, Indiana's the number one overall seed. Now it was a much better Syracuse team, but it wasn't a better Syracuse team than that Indiana team was an Indiana team. And that zone thing really bothered the Hoosiers in the Sweet 16. Hoosiers go home. Massive disappointment for a team that had been a one seed. That's what happens when Syracuse plays. So even though I love San Diego State's team and think if they win that game, they can last a while, don't think they win that thing, and I have Syracuse moving in. West Virginia against Morehead State. Every high major team Morehead State has played, including a team like Kentucky that did not turn out to have a great season, has pretty much crushed Morehead State. So I think West Virginia adds to that collection. Clemson against Rutgers. Hard game to call because there's no mismatch here. Each team is a meager offensive team, and each team is an overwhelming defensive team. I think there are a few more weapons on the Rutgers side, and I went with them. And then Houston, in the 15-2 game, I say the Cougars move along. Illinois over Loyola, tough game, maybe a little tougher than the Illini would like, but they're a better basketball team. Tennessee versus Oak State, more definition to the Oak State attack than there is to Tennessee. And that comes back to Cunningham, but also they have several other terrific scorers. Likely, Anderson, they can make buckets. Tennessee really struggles with that. Syracuse against West Virginia. Bob Huggins has had some time to see how that zone works through his time in the Big East when he played against the Cuse. So I think he'll be a little bit better equipped to do it. And he's also got an army of great shooters. I think they take out Syracuse. Rutgers and Houston, don't trust Rutgers to be able to make enough buckets to win that game, but I'm not in love with Houston as a two seed. I understand why they are. Somebody had to be. They were the most qualified available, although probably not the kind of two seed that we would ordinarily see in this event. So Rutgers against Houston. Houston moves along. Illinois versus Oklahoma State. This is the one for the Illini. They got a great region here, a great draw, except that game. If it happens and they have to face the Cowboys and Cade Cunningham, that's going to be a real challenge. Now, they have Io DeSumo to defend Cade Cunningham a little bit. They can throw a few different bodies at him, but it's going to be hard to slow him down. Oak State doesn't have a lot of experience going against great size. That was not one thing that was a big strength of the Big 12. They had great players at every other position, but unlike the Big 10, which had so many terrific centers, they did not have a lot of that except for at Texas in the Big 12. So Kofi Coburn has to be a big difference maker for the Illini in that game. I think he will be. West Virginia versus Houston in the Sweet 16. I'm going to go with West Virginia. Wouldn't that be interesting, though, to see two guys, such veteran coaches as Bob Huggins and Kelvin Sampson, go against one another? It'd be a really terrific matchup. But Mountaineers, a little bit more dynamic offense, a little bit more consistent at that end. Great defense for Houston will make it difficult for them. But the Mountaineers play Illinois there, I think. Fighting Illini, move along, just a better basketball team. They're going to beat who's ever at the bottom of this bracket if they get through Oklahoma State. That's the big hurdle. And if they do, they'll be in the Final Four, very close to home. There will be a lot of the Orange Crush who will want to drive across the 2 hours or so on I-74 to get to Indianapolis. Unfortunately, there will not be a lot of seats available in this particular year's Final Four. And now we get to the Final Four. And if we have Gonzaga, Alabama, Illinois, and Purdue, won't that be a terrific Final Four? One, because I'll have gotten it right. And two, terrific teams. They should be fascinating games. Purdue versus Illinois. Now, they have played in the Big Ten prior to this, and most games in the Big Ten were certainly highly competitive. I do think at this stage of the season, Illinois is just tailor-made to continue moving forward. They have everything working for them at this point, and I believe they would go on and win that game against the Boilermakers. In the opposite game, Javon Quinterly playing at point guard for Alabama. If they're in the Final Four, he's playing at peak level. And, of course, Gonzaga trying to be the undefeated team with Jalen Suggs, probably at that point the best pro prospect in the Final Four, a guy who can absolutely carry his team forward. Corey Kispert, America's best jump shooter. A lot to say for the Zags. I think they take out Alabama, play Illinois in the final, and then it becomes really interesting. Because the matchup, probably the two best teams that we've seen, at least by the time we've gotten to March, each of them has reached a peak level. Illinois struggled early, not to the extent that they weren't fine, but they weren't elite, but they became elite as the season wore on. Gonzaga's been that from the very beginning and hasn't really lost any of its edge. So what a classic title game that would be. I just think Gonzaga has too much strength to be able to not move forward and win that game. The problem for them is, can they deal with the massive power of Kofi Coburn inside? Drew Timmy, a big, strong player, has never had to defend anybody quite like Kofi. 285, 290 pounds, solid muscle, doesn't get moved. And it's really difficult to play against. Can you get him into foul trouble? That may be where Timmy makes the difference, because Timmy's very good at making offensive moves, getting players off balance. That could be the ticket to winning the game for Gonzaga. It's going to be a great NCAA tournament. It's a delight to have it back again. We'll look forward to hearing from all of you about what you think of my picks. I'm sure by the end, there's going to be a game somewhere along the line that you'll wish that I hadn't picked. And I'm hopeful that there's one that you said, hey, Mike DeCourcy told me to pick that game and it helped me win my pool. Thanks for listening.